Good evening and happy Thanksgiving. It's good to see you this evening. I don't have any announcements regarding our service, so let's begin with our opening hymn, Come Ye Thankful People Come, number 892. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we approach our Lord, let us confess the fact that we tend to take for granted all that He provides us. Father, forgive us for forgetting all that You provide for us. Even when we remember to thank You, it is usually shallow and does not include all that You have given. Help us to remember to thank You not only during this holiday, but every day of the year. Grant us strength to give to others as You have given to us. Our Lord's forgiveness is not shallow. He has made all things new. In Christ Jesus, opening the doors to the eternal banquet hall, inviting sinners to dine with Him as the gracious host and guest. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of the Word, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Father, You who give all good gifts, grant us hearts that are truly thankful for all that You have given us, especially for the forgiveness won for us on the cross of Calvary, that we might praise You in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ, Your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with You in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the scripture readings.
The Old Testament reading comes from Deuteronomy chapter 8. The whole commandment that I command you today shall be, today you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that He might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep His commandments or not. And He humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that He might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in His ways and by fearing Him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks and water, of fountains and springs, flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills you can dig copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land He has given you. This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament reading comes from the first book of Timothy, chapter 2. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks. Please rise. The Holy Gospel is according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as He entered a village, He was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voice, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When He saw them, He said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving Him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And He said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of the Lord. Now that we have heard God's word, let us confess our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our hymn of the day, hymn number 893. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, dear Lord. Amen. Our text for this Thanksgiving Eve is our gospel lesson as it was read earlier. It is taking me a long time to realize this, but over the years I have come to learn that we human beings are not very good at taking care of ourselves. There are several things that we should be doing that are good for us, and most of us just don't do them. I'd like to share a couple of statistics with you, if I could, here this evening. If I could have my first slide. First statistic is this. 19.3% of Americans exercise regularly. If you look at that chart, the younger people, 18 to 44 years, about 20-25%, somewhere in there of them. And as you get older, of course, it goes lower and lower and lower. And men exercise more than women, okay, in the years 1999 through 2009. Currently, in 2024, approximately 19.3% of Americans exercise regularly. And by exercising regularly, they mean cardiovascular exercise as well as weight training exercise, cardiovascular exercise that gets your heart rate pumping and moving, so they don't count just plain walking as exercise in these. If we could have our next slide. This next one, 9% of Americans eat the daily amount of vegetables recommended by doctors in the world today, which is 5 full servings of fruits or vegetables a day. If you look on this chart, Illinois is right there in the middle with a median number of servings of vegetables per day per person of 1.6, not even close to the 5 that we should be getting. These statistics surprised me, first of all, because I didn't expect that many people to be exercising regularly, and I expected more people to be eating their daily vegetable and fruit intake. And so, I thought they would be closer to each other, not 19.3 exercising and 9% eating their vegetables. They were surprising, okay? They threw me for a loop a little bit when I saw them. We have a surprising, or maybe not so surprising, statistic in our gospel lesson for today. Only 10% of the lepers who were healed by Jesus came back to thank him. Now, the lepers, of course, had been in a tough spot, hadn't they? You know, not only did they have a horrible and a painful disease, but they were ostracized from their community. They weren't allowed to go near anybody except, of course, their fellow lepers. That's why they stood at a distance from Jesus and shouted out to him, "Master, heal us." Okay? They couldn't go to the temple, to church. They couldn't go see their families. They couldn't do much of anything except to sit outside of a town in their colonies and eat and drink there. And then Jesus comes along and he listens to their plea and he heals them. And their entire lives are turned around, aren't they? They're no longer sick. They're no longer in pain. They can go wherever they want to go. They can see whomever they want to. They can go to the temple and be pronounced clean by the high priest. They could do whatever they wanted to. It was incredible. But only one of the 10 returned to Jesus to thank him. 10%. Now, we don't know why only one of them came back. You know, the others might have thought that maybe they didn't need to. You know, they needed to just follow Jesus' instructions and go to the high priest. Maybe a couple of them might have even been unhappy that they were healed because they'd gotten comfortable in the lifestyle that they were living in. We just don't know why they didn't come back to thank Jesus. What we do know is that only one showed enough gratitude and faith to come back and thank Jesus. And that is the only one that Jesus says the words, "Your faith has made you well." We don't know how much faith the others had, but it doesn't look very good, does it? It reminds me a little bit of how the people would flock to Jesus when he was performing miracles, right? When he was healing people, when he raised somebody from the dead, when he walked on water and all of this stuff, you know, fed the 5,000, whatever. People flocked to him when he was performing miracles, and then they would leave him in droves when he started teaching them about the gospel, about all that he had to go through for them. Most experts agree that this is a pretty good indication, this gospel lesson is a pretty good indication of the success rate that Jesus had, about 10% of getting people to follow him. That's it. That's even worse, a worse success rate than weather forecasters on the news. The incredible thing was, though, it didn't stop Jesus from healing people, did it? He knew that only one of the 10 was going to come back and thank him. He's God's son, after all. He knew it all. He knew only one was going to come back to thank him, and yet he still healed all 10, didn't he? It didn't stop him from teaching people, did it? He knew that people would leave him in droves once he started talking to them about God's truth and God's love and God's mercy and grace found in the cross and in the empty tomb. He knew people would leave him once he started teaching all of that stuff, but it didn't stop him. He still taught them. And it most definitely didn't stop him from going to the cross. Again, Jesus knows most people won't want anything to do with him. And yet he still willingly went to the cross and died for them. Statistically speaking, the church is doing a little bit better today than Jesus did in his day. Maybe the better way to say it is that the Holy Spirit is doing a little bit better of a job today than in Jesus' day, because about 25% of those who have been baptized and confirmed will be still going to church as adults. They may fall away from the church for a while during their teenage years and college years, but about 25%, about one-fourth of those who were both baptized and confirmed in the church will still be going to church as an adult. And it's a very similar situation for them as it was for the 10 lepers, isn't it? We had a terrible, terrible disease. And because of this terrible disease, we couldn't go to where we want to go or should want to go. Heaven, could we? And there was nothing we could do about it. We couldn't cure ourselves of this terrible disease, could we? But then along comes Jesus. He washes us clean in the waters of holy baptism by the power of the cross and his sacrifice, so that now we are free to go to heaven. But only 25% of those who have been freed through the waters of baptism and then confirmed later on in the church, only 25% of them come back to church. It's a little bit more than the lepers, about twice as many as the lepers of percentage-wise, right? But only 25% come back to hear his word, to receive his sacrament, and yes, to thank him for healing us of our sinful disease. That's the people who, of course, were born and at least partially raised in the church. Overall, if we could have our last slide, overall, the latest statistics tell us that only about 28% of Americans go to church on a weekly basis, on a regular basis. Illinois, if you look right in there, is right there in that the third one down, the 27 to 32% area, right there at the national average. Now, I have to admit that when I researched all of this, when I first got this idea and I started researching all of this, I was completely surprised that of these three really good things for you, going to church, exercising regularly, eating your fruits and vegetables, that of these three things, the church is doing the best. Okay? More people are going to church than are exercising, and way more people are going to church than are eating all of their fruits and vegetables. The church is doing the best. 28% of all Americans, 25% of those baptized and confirmed, 19.3% exercising regularly, a piddly number of 9% eating their daily fruits and vegetables. I think this all goes to show that the things that are the best for us are the things that we are least likely wanting to do, doesn't it? That's a sermon for another day. At least, though, the church is still the best. Not very good, 28%, but it's still the best. And that's good because it's the only one that gets you into heaven. You don't get into heaven by exercising regularly. You don't get into heaven by eating all of your vegetables. That won't do it either. Actually, going to church doesn't do it either. But when you come to church, you hear about the way that you get to go to heaven, which is through the cross and the empty tomb of Jesus Christ. And so that is the one that gives you the chance to go to heaven. And even though 28% is the highest of those three things that are so good for us, it is still awfully low, isn't it? But it also shows us that we have two things that we can be thankful for this Thanksgiving. The first is this. We can be thankful that we have the 28% in the United States, right? And that we are part of that 28%. Because it is only by that faith that we will get to see God and live forever in heaven. And the fact that just over a quarter of people in our country believe, well, that is good, because it could be much worse. It's not great, but it is good. Second thing that we can be thankful for is that we have the opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the other 72%. You know, God doesn't need us to show the world his love, but he chooses to let us participate. And that is a huge privilege. That is a huge opportunity. And it's something we can be thankful for. It won't always be easy, will it, to share the love of God with others? And frankly, most of them probably won't listen to you. After all, they didn't even listen to Jesus when he spoke. But it's a wonderful opportunity still the same. First, because you get to be like Jesus. They didn't listen to him either. And frankly, people still don't. Right? But also, it's a wonderful opportunity because there is no better way to thank Jesus Christ for his love and his grace and his forgiveness than by sharing that same love, grace, and forgiveness with all those around you. Amen. Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light for our path. Amen. Please rise as we now sing our hymn of praise, number 894. Please bow your heads and pray with me. Almighty God, your mercies are new every morning, and you graciously provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Heavenly Father, you crown the fields with your blessing and permit us to gather in the fruits of the earth. As stewards of your creation, may we receive your gifts in humble thankfulness and share your bounty with those in need. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Father of mercies and God of all comfort, our only help in time of need, look with favor upon your servants who are on our hearts and our minds right now. Assure them of your mercy, deliver them from the temptations of the evil one, and give them patience and comfort in their trials. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And Heavenly Father, God of all grace, govern our hearts so that we may never forget your blessings, but steadfastly thank and praise you for all your goodness in this life until with all your saints we praise you eternally in your heavenly kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us give thanks for all the blessings God has bestowed upon us. Our Lord has given us his own body and blood in this blessed sacrament. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise that you have given us your Son in this holy meal. Help us to grow in faith toward you and in love for one another until the day you call us to the great banquet in heaven. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.